Department of HPB and Minimal Access, SIDS Surat. And his interest also coincides similar to Dr. Karthik. It is colorectal HPV surgery, and Dr. Dhawal has numerous publications to his credit.
Topic today is we'll be concentrating on the management of the anastomotic leak, particularly in the whenever we are operating for the colorectal cases. So as we all know, this in the last two or three decades, the improving in the surgical safety has been a lot right now. And certain factors which are involved and responsible for this is preoperative preparation, understanding of our own antibiotic prophylaxis, different kind of surgical techniques, as Dr. Karthik mentioned, like ICG and everything, postoperative management. So these are the factors responsible for improving in the surgical safety and outcome. But still, the complications such as related to the colorectal anastomosis are continues to occur. So if you see the specific complications related to the anastomosis is a bleeding, strictures, fistula, but what we are going to look out today is dehiscence and leakage, and particularly the management aspect. The prevention has already been mentioned. So before going ahead, let us see the incidence. So what are the incidences at the in the literature? The 2 to 7% incidence has been mentioned as an overall anastomotic for the colorectal surgeries. But when we divide, it's as compared to the ileocolic anastomosis, which is responsible for around 1 to 3%, as compared to the coloanal anastomosis, particularly in low LAR or ultra low anterior resection, it's around 10 to 20%. So it's clearly seen whenever the distal anastomosis involved in the lower rectum, the incidence is much higher. Now this publication on Annals in 2007 has tried to see that what are the timing of this leak presentation and the behavior of the leak. So what they could identify, the almost most of the leaks are detected after 5 to 7 days of the postoperative days, and almost half of these leaks are seen or detected after patient being discharged from the hospital, and up to 12% incidence they have detected after postop day 30. So the message over here is you need to keep your threshold very low to suspect any in the alternative course of outcome should be suspected for a anastomotic leak even after day post-op day 30. And what happens with these delayed or late leaks? Typical features may be a low-grade fever, prolonged ileus, and some of the non-specific symptoms. As I said, whenever you are seeing some altered course, maybe just prolonged ileus or low-grade fever. So this time, these are the cases those who are suspicious for the delayed leak. Now, the definition and manifestation, particularly if you see the clinical signs like pain, fever, tachycardia, peritonitis, feculent equivalent drainage from the drainage side, or maybe a main wound. Radiographic signs like fluid collections, gas-containing collections, and intraoperating whenever patients are intervening for the surgically, like gross enteric spillage and the gross anastomotic disruption on visual examination. As the risk factors already has been described by Dr. Karthik, but what I want to stress upon and I want to certain points what we need to see. So one of the very identifiable things what we have seen in the literature, that is extraperitoneal anastomosis and the intraperitoneal anastomosis. So whenever there is extraperitoneal anastomosis, it's having a significant higher risk, as we have seen, that is 6.6% versus 1.5%. To see the overall 2.5%, this was the literature search. And if you see the extraperitoneal anastomotic leak, so what are the factors responsible? It's the distance of the anastomosis from the anal verge, the anastomotic ischemia, male gender, and obesity. These are the, in literature, these are the certainly significantly associated for the leak and indicating the risk for the extraperitoneal anastomotic leak. And the factors in intraperitoneal, which has been significantly identified, like ASA grade 3 or 4, emergency surgeries, prolonged operative time, the time taken for more than 4 hours in this colorectal surgeries, they are having a higher risk in the literature. And particularly in the ileocolic anastomosis, hands-shown as compared to the stapled anastomosis. For the particular so right-sided anastomosis, whenever it is done with the hands-shown, the incidence has been identified 6% as compared to the 1.4%. So these are the studies from either maybe a retrospective studies or a prospective study, and one of the meta-analysis of 6 trials. So I hope every participants can identify the free peritoneal gas. So this is the feature what we are observing in many of our patients after the surgery. Even if we are doing some of the radiological examination or simple X-ray, we are finding a free gas under the diaphragm in X-ray, or maybe a free gas intraperitoneally. So what is this post-operative pneumoperitoneum? So it's a free peritoneal air after the surgery, and it can be seen up to 60% of the cases in laparotomies and 25% of the cases in the laparoscopic procedures. And if you see the behavior of this free intraperitoneal gas, the 2/3 of the cases will be resolved in next 2 days, and almost 97% of the cases will be resolved in 5 days. But still, there are some cases, those who are having a detection of this free intraperitoneal air in even more than 5 days. And what is the proposed management of this pneumoperitoneum? So whenever if we are having a post-operative cases with the clinical signs of peritonitis, we are straight away going ahead with some sort of intervention if there is a clear-cut signs of leak or peritonitis. But if we have done some of the X-ray abdomen and if there is no gas present, we simply go with the observation. And again, the observation, during the course of observation, if deterioration, the surgery. Now, what happens when we have the free intraperitoneal gas? How we have to take on it? Again, then there are two types. Either patient is hemodynamically stable or no sepsis, then patient continue going with the observation. And if there is a hemodynamic instability or sepsis, patient can be going with the surgery. Few patients, those who are not having a clear-cut signs of peritonitis, so these are the cases where the CT scan need to be done. And in the CT scan, if you're finding a free fluid or a clear-cut signs of leak on the contrast incision, at that time, the surgical intervention will be needed. So to explain this in a better manner, what I'm going to show this case was what I've done with the iliotransverse stapled anastomosis post bowel ischemia and gangrene. But the patient on post-op day 5 after the anastomosis had some problems like clinical signs of like distension and mild pain. But there is no clinical signs of sepsis or peritonitis. So what I've done, a plain CT abdomen. So if you see this plain CT abdomen, we could see a free intraperitoneal gas, right? But what important, and a dilated stomach, this is a grossly dilated stomach, lot of free this is a gas under the in the intraperitoneal region, dilated duodenum, dilated small bowel, these are the small bowel which is dilated, drain in C2, but there is no free fluid in the abdomen. See, this patient is clinically quite stable. So what I did, I would just hold on because patient is not having any signs and there is no fluid. So in this case, so even post-op day 5, free intraperitoneal gas doesn't matter. Patient is clinically quite stable, but still after 4 days, patient continued to have issues. And this time patient is present with the hypoxia. So again, what I did a plain scan along with the rectal contrast. So what you can see is these are transverse colon and contrast is reaching up to the anastomotic side, right up to the distal bowel, which has been anastomosed. Again, there is no free fluid. There is no active contrast leak. So again, I have continued with the conservative line of management. And later on, he was diagnosed to have a bilateral pneumonitis and a fungal sepsis. So hence, this patient not having any leakage and required any intervention for the bowel leakage. This is how you have to take on with your investigation. So what our protocol is, investigation in the suspected case, just do a plain CT scan. Don't venture directly into the IV contrast or any other oral contrast in the things. Just do a plain CT scan. If you are finding a pneumoperitoneum without collection, don't do anything. But if you are finding a pneumoperitoneum with collection, then use a rectal contrast. Because we are particularly talking about the colorectal anastomosis, the anastomosis which has been done post to the transverse colon, usually they are quite amenable to reach to the rectal contrast. But the right-sided anastomosis may be, or particularly in the ileo-ascending anastomosis, sometime rectal contrast would not be enough. We don't use oral contrast because these are the suspected cases. They might be having some sort of ileus, some sort of sepsis, which might be leading to reaching the contrast orally ingested to reach that site. So rectal contrast would be the better idea to use and to diagnose the particularly the leak. Now, if you are finding a leak during with this lateral contrast, it's fine enough. You can go ahead with the surgery or maybe required if there's an uncontrolled leak. But if the leak is not demonstrated, then what are the next steps should be the IV contrast. If there is no leak demonstrated, but still there is some sort of collection inside the abdomen, we don't know whether it's a bowel wall, but we don't know whether it's a bowel loop. At that time only, we use the IV contrast to take a surgical decision. Before that, we are happy enough to just to use a plain CT abdomen along with the administered rectal contrast. So now, after diagnosing, particularly the management and the treatment aspect, so I have divided the treatment aspect in two parts. Either there is an intraperitoneal anastomotic leak or an extraperitoneal anastomotic leak. So intraperitoneal anastomotic leak management would be dependent upon the patient's clinical conditions, nature of the leak, and whenever the surgery is going on, what are the findings operatively. Now, one entity is called as subclinical leak. many of the institutions have a protocol to ingest a rectal contrast in a particular in the lower rectal anastomosis in the cases of LAR or ultra LAR and to check whether there is a leak. So these are the cases when you just see outpouching of this and this ingested contrast, but there is no standing, though no surrounding inflammation. Patient is also not having any clinical signs. So these are the patients also who are having a labeled as a clinical leak. Means the leak just detected in the radiological examination, and these patients are expectantly managed the conservatively only. They don't need anything, and they just heal by its own. Now, a patients with the localized peritonitis or a low grade sepsis. So these are the patients where the diagnostic imaging, as I mentioned, and with the, using a plain CT and followed by rectal contrast protocol, you have to go ahead. And if we are detecting a free intraperitoneal leak, patients should be taken for the operating room and surgical management. Now, if the patient is having a small or contained abscess at the site of anastomosis, which may be less than 3 cm, so these are the cases which can be managed, particularly in the considering the clinical condition of the patient, can be managed with the conservative line of management with the broad spectrum antibiotic and the bowel rest. But the larger abscess for more than 3 cm or a multiloculated collection or a multiple collection in the abdomen, one may take a chance to attempt to put a percutaneous drainage tube in form of pigtail. But the patient or those who are having a diffuse collection and a peritonitis, they are the cases to have a surgical intervention in form of laparotomy. Certainly, the generalized peritonitis and high-grade sepsis with hypotension, they need a resuscitation and surgical management straight away. Now, what are the according to the findings intraoperatively? If we are many a times what we find a phlegmon at the site of anastomosis because of that thickened infected omentum and a surrounding mesocolon. So these are particularly difficult to resect and difficult to dissect. So when this kind of situation encountered, the safest approach would be just to put a para-anastomotic drains and perform a temporary fecal diversion. Don't venture in any of the other procedure in this kind of case. These are sick patients, these are difficult patients, so don't do any kind of resection. Just give a good lavage, put a drain, do a diversion and just come out. So cases where the major anastomotic defect, there is no, we can see the anastomotic site easily, there is a major defect which is can be defined as more than 1 cm of the dehiscence or more than 1/3 of the circumference which has been dehiscence for the site of anastomosis. So the options in this kind of cases, maybe you can resect the anastomotic site, create an end stoma, put a you can close down the distal end, particularly whenever there is a left-sided anastomosis, you don't have enough length to take it out, or maybe at that time you can just close it down using a staple called as a Hartmann's procedure. And some cases where you have enough length, you can just take it, bring it out as a mucous fistula. Second is resection of the anastomotic site and a re-anastomosis with the proximal diversion. This option should be taken whenever there is an empty bowel, because the segment between the diverged part and the anastomosis part, if it is loaded with the feculent material, maybe particularly in the maybe liquid or maybe solid, but it's not have a very good idea to keep that kind of segment inside. If it is an elective case without any peritonitis, you can just give a distal bowel wash, you can take a chance, but otherwise certainly just take an end stoma rather than keeping that loaded colon segment inside the abdomen. And right-sided, particularly whenever there's an ileorectal ileocolic anastomosis, this time patient would be having enough mobile small bowel and enough distal colon available to come out as a end stoma. And this is the option when one can take the exteriorization of the both ends of the bowel end in the from the abdomen. Now, in selected certain patients in whom the defect is very minor and a tissue quality is good, there is not much amount of peritonitis, patient is quite stable, at that time one can take or consider to do a primary repair, just close down, put one or two more sutures at the site and do a proximal diversion. So this we have seen, but there are certain challenges. Now I'm quoting one case. So this is a patient who has operated for LAR, open for a distal rectal growth, and she was having a obstructive growth. Now you see the if you can but unfortunately she had a leak. The second surgery what they have done a end stoma and Hartmann procedure, but still patient had a retracted stoma. They did a third surgery, but still the condition unfortunately is same. Patient is having a retracted stoma, patient is having a burst abdomen, patient is having a drain which is draining feculent material, this retracted stoma leading to the subcut level fasciitis and inflammation inside abdomen. Also, there is a lot of collections. and sepsis and hypotension. There's a bad scenario. There's a challenge is what we are facing. And once I opened the case, you can see this, all the planes which has been filled with the feculent material. And in the intraperitoneal aspect also, there are a lot of feculent collection was there. So these are the real challenges cases which is testing your skills and mental things in the time whenever they are presenting to you. So the standard thing what one can do is what she had, she was having that Hartman stump which was leaking. She was having that retracted stump in an ischemic segment. What I would do, so I would refashion the Hartman stump putting a stapler. I would resect that ischemic segment which has been retracted at the side from the side of stoma because of vascular compromises, the infected thickened omentum, necro skin, subcutaneous tissue, lot of pus flakes. So these are the real cases where we are getting the challenges to manage. So the take home message is never reconstruct in this kind of patient. Do a minimum. Don't do any heroics because they are really sick patients, severe sepsis. They are not going to bear a major prolonged surgeries. Never reconstruct. Always do an end stoma. Always expect and explain the ventilator support, a prolonged ventilator support. They are a burst abdomen patient. Put a tension sutures and keep patient relaxed. Always adhere with the DVT prophylaxis. These are the patient who those are likely to develop the DVTs and pulmonary embolism. Always put a multiple drainage to drain out all the potential cavities, those who are likely to develop more and more collection inside. And one of the very important aspect is the nutrition. These are the patient, the nutrition is the key to fight this kind of patient in the sepsis. Of course, we are not talking a lot, but nutrition is a very big subject in this kind of patient. I on at least 30 kilocalorie per kg per day and at least 2 gram per kg per day protein diet. So always have a good access for the nutrition, put through the Ryle's tube and do a enteral feeding. And certainly these are not the cases to opt for the parenteral nutrition. So always to have an enteral access for the feeding and nutrition. Next is extraperitoneal anastomotic leak. Again, the factors depend upon for the managements like clinical stability, radiographic findings, and feasibility of the image-guided percutaneous drainage. Because it's an extraperitoneal patient is not having any leak inside the peritoneum, so these are the cases, those who are having slightly different kind of management. Of course, the patient, those who are having a generalized peritonitis from the extraperitoneal segment and high-grade sepsis, the only option as in the previous segment would be the operative management. Now, this patient presenting with the pelvic abscess, the factors responsible for the management like patient's clinical condition, location of this abscess, and the continuity with the leak. Proximal diversion is always warranted, whatever the management is. If the patient of the extraperitoneal anastomotic leak with the contained abscess, the intravenous antibiotic and the conservative management can be an option to have. But the abscess drainage is required whenever the collection is more than 3 cm, and the drainage route may be CT guided, transabdominal, transvaginal, transanal, transrectal, and rarely transiatic or gluteal, transgluteal approach, depending upon the which planes are involved because of the abscess. A very low pelvic abscess, that those who are very much in continuity with the anastomotic leak, particularly in the ultra LAR cases. So these are the patients, just do an examination under anesthesia, one can see the boginess, and do a transrectal or transanastomotic drainage for these abscesses. The point is make the wide opening at the site of anastomosis whenever there is a seen dehiscence, and insert a mellicus or mushroom tip catheter inside the abscess cavity and do a proximal diversion. The advantage in this extraperitoneal leak is having a peripheral, the pelvic cavity is there. So the because of fibrosis, they heal by its own. The diversion would be good enough. No need to put any sutures over there. Just drain it out. It would be fine enough. So I guess I've covered almost most practical aspect to manage this kind of leak, what we are dealing with the colorectal surgeries. I'm open for questions, if any, from the participants. Yeah.